This is what our reporter Yash Jain has been able to confirm, and we should actually get him on the line as well. He has been able to confirm from NCLT directly that a petition has been filed this evening by Cyrus Mistry. Now, the petition is essentially filed under Section 241 and 242 of the Companies Act. Now, under that Act, they have basically filed this petition citing oppression and mismanagement. This is what our reporter has been able to confirm. The petition is under 241 and 242 of the Companies Act, and it cites oppression and mismanagement. We are trying to get some more details. And in fact, our Network 18 colleague, our CNN News 18 colleague Ashok Bagri also had been able to confirm this information. So he has a copy of the petition and we'll try to get him. But as of now, let's bring in RS Ruma, the Luna, the former ED at SEBI. Mr. Luna, thanks for joining in. Now, what we know so far is that Cyrus Mistry has moved the NCLT. He has filed a petition under 241, 242 of Companies Act. And what we know is that he's citing oppression and mismanagement. Your comments, sir?
Well, in my view, he should have filed this kind of petition much earlier. And as a matter of fact, I feel that his resignation, in fact, may weaken his position. Because generally speaking, this kind of petition is filed by the people who are in the management control and who are threatened that they will be taken away from this management. But in this case, I think he has tendered his resignation and then he's going to NCLT for seeking relief. I don't know what kind of reliefs he's seeking there now. One need to wait for that. But generally speaking, the scope of this petition is quite wide. It's not necessary that one must be in the management and then he should file this petition. The shareholders can file and he's entitled to do that. But what he's exactly looking for, he's seeking some a change in the management of the Tata Group as such. He's looking for some changes in the contract which the Tata Group companies have entered with some parties or some other contractual arrangements, I don't know. So I think one need to look at exactly that what relief he's asking for and then one can see.
Mr. Luna, you just pointed out that you believe that Cyrus Mistry should have done this earlier. And I think that is the question that a lot of people are asking, that to start with, he always had the option of moving the NCLT. He chose not to exercise the option. Instead, he chose to battle it out through the route of corporate democracy at the EGMs. And yesterday, he decided that the EGM route was not going to be the best course of action. In fact, he called it a destructive course of action. And now the decision to move the NCLT. You said that you don't think that this would perhaps find muster. Is that your sense?
Well, you see, I think strategically he should have gone earlier, but maybe I think he might have made some assessment that some of the major shareholders like foreign portfolio investors, insurance companies or mutual funds, they probably are not likely to support him. And he might have thought that probably that will not work because his representation to the investors, the shareholders, was with the view that he should get some support from those shareholders and the Tata's resolution wouldn't get through. But now I think considering that that may not happen, and probably it is inevitable that he will be removed from all these companies one by one. And he thought that it's better now to go to the NCLT. Because if he had gone earlier, probably he could have got relief like even stopping these EGMs from NCLT. But he had not opted for that kind of relief. So I think it is for him to see now. That
Luna, what will be the future course of action from here on? What is the process?
You see, this, as far as NCLT is concerned, they of course will look into his petition and they will, they can give the interim reliefs, they can ask for the reply from the other side and then give some relief. So it all depends at what kind of reliefs he's looking for. And then based on that, the NCLT can pass the orders.
Yes, I would imagine that we are given to understand that the petition has been filed under Section 241 and 242 of the Companies Act, citing oppression and mismanagement. You want to, Mr. Luna, for the benefit of our viewers, perhaps share details with us as far as filing under these two particular sections are concerned, 241 and 242 of the Companies Act?
Well, under these sections, you know, these shareholders who are entitled to file this petition is basically that they should constitute 10% of the paid-up capital of the company. There should be 100 shareholders who can join together and file this kind of petition. And the basic objective of petition is that when the company is being run against the public interest or against the interests of the stakeholders or shareholders, or there is some kind of fraudulent activities going on. So any kind of this kind of overall mismanagement is happening in the company, which is not in the interest of the shareholders in general, and particularly the minority shareholders who probably have no say in the management. So those people can go to NCLT, and NCLT then can pass the appropriate orders. They can give the directions how the management can function. They can appoint their own directors also on the board of this company. So these are the kind of directions they can issue. So it depends that what reliefs are sought for.
Sure.
And then
in
what
fact, Mr. Luna, as my colleague Kevin reminds me, the Tata Group had actually filed a caveat in the NCLT on the 25th of October, a day after Cyrus Mistry was, the decision to actually oust Cyrus Mistry, which was on the 24th of October. So, which basically means that the NCLT will need to hear the Tatas as well before any kind of relief is provided, right?
That's right. The purpose of caveat is that no expiry order should be passed. They should be heard before the order is passed.
Yes, so just for the benefit of our viewers, this is the background information. The Tata Group had already filed a caveat in the NCLT on the 25th of October, anticipating legal action from Cyrus Mistry. But it's taken Cyrus Mistry 8 weeks to actually take legal recourse. And we understand now that he's filed a petition in the NCLT under Sections 241 and 242 of the Companies Act. Mr. Luna, you know, the NCLT is a new forum in that sense. So this is also going to be uncharted territory for corporate India, isn't it?
No, I don't think so, because earlier all these powers were with the company law board, and now NCLT is superseding that company law board. And I would say that now, because the members of NCLT are supposed to be much more qualified and experienced in the corporate affairs, so I think this is rather a better forum as compared to the previous days.
Okay, please hold on, Mr. Luna. We've also got Mr. Shailesh Haribhakti joining us. Mr. Haribhakti, just yesterday we were discussing that this is probably the beginning of a different kind of a battle, and the first salvo has now been fired by Cyrus Mistry. He's moved the NCLT under Section 241 and 242 of the Companies Act. Your first reaction, Mr. Haribhakti?
I mean, when I read his full statement and also the video clip on how he actually, what he actually feels, I was certain that adjudication would follow. Because that was the key operative word.
That's right.
In his statement. And so this does not come
as a surprise.
As a huge surprise. And this is the right forum. I mean, he wants to make sure that his grievance is adjudicated.
Mm-hmm.
So, and therefore, he's gone to the right source.
But Mr. Haribhakti, we were just in conversation with Mr. R.S. Luna, and he believes that, Cyrus Mistry ought to have done this earlier, which is, a sentiment expressed by several other experts that we've been speaking to. In fact, I think the Tata Group also anticipated Mr. Mistry taking the legal route, because they had filed a caveat in the NCLT on the 25th of October, a day after the decision was taken to remove Cyrus Mistry. So, in terms of legal standing, in terms of legal scrutiny, to suggest that there has been mismanagement and oppression of the minorities, how would you read this?
You know, I think we should wait. We've got a new NCLT.
Mm.
We've got the whole institution will settle down. I hope and I wish that it kind of has the wings that we all wanted it to have. But it is now with us, and it is the forum where all high courts have transferred all corporate affairs matters to the NCLT. And that happened on one day in December, 15th of December. Everything after that has gone there. So I think everything will depend on the way this forum matures. And that will be a function of how the matters are dealt with. So I can't find fault with timing, because not everything occurs to everybody at the same time, and there are strategies and aspects to consider. So I would not bother about the timing. I would rather want to see whether the outcome is mature and whether the outcome results in the overall objective, which is to make the Tata Group stronger, make the Tata Group more powerful, make all the things that both parties have been talking about, the positive things, actually come to be true.
When Tata Sons had moved that ex parte order, or had moved NCLT on 25th, they had said very categorically, I'm quoting here, that the caveat will ensure that NCLT cannot pass an ex parte order against Tata Sons. So, Mr. Haribhakti, just a point on that. Does this significantly cushion them then? Is it true that they will not be, NCLT will not be able to pass an ex parte order then against Tata Sons?
Yeah, of course. Why should anything be passed ex parte? That is a absolutely wrong way to start any institution. And in a properly constituted institution, I would certainly want to expect that both people who have something to say be heard in a proper way, with full time and with full respect, and then only the sense of adjudication will actually emerge.
But Mr. Haribhakti and Mr. Luna, let's look at the charge or the plea or the prayer that Cyrus Mistry is making, citing oppression and mismanagement. Now, as the Tatas have been articulating through all of their statements, that Mr. Mistry has been on the board of Tata Sons since 2006. Mr. Mistry has been in the position before he was removed of the chairman for almost a period of 4 years. You know, how does this stick then, the charge of mismanagement and oppression? And even as far as oppression is concerned, because at least as far as the EGMs that have already been conducted, you know, the vote has gone in favor of the Tata Sons. Mr. Haribhakti?
No, it's the EGM vote and the oppression mismanagement charge have got nothing to do with each other. The EGM was for the simple and clinical task of removing a person from the board. And the task of the NCLT is to adjudicate whether any oppression or mismanagement has happened. Mm-hmm. So these are two completely distinct aspects.
So do you believe that given the fact that Mr. Mistry himself was a board member since 2006, was the chairman for a period of 4 years, has now decided to move this petition only after his removal, do you think that that may perhaps not hold water?
Why, you know, it's... okay, let's go to the earlier instances where such an action has been taken, the oppression and mismanagement provisions. They were not ever before, to my memory, moved by an insider. Mm-hmm. They were moved by people who felt that their interest might have been affected. And so this is creating new ground in this entire set of adjudication and the provisions relating to. They will be tested. This will be new ground.
This will be new ground. Mr. Luna, a quick comment from you on how this is actually going to be testing new ground.
No, I would not agree on that, because there are ample number of petitions where the existing managements, people who are the managing directors and so on, and they are threatened that they are going to be removed by them. And the majority directors in the board, they are forcing him to act in certain manner, or the managing director is not in a position to perform in that position. They can go to CLB and ask for this kind of reliefs. So it is not that person who in the management, he cannot go to the CLB or now the NCLT. That is fine. But yes, now he is no more in the management control. But certainly he can seek certain leaves. He can very well question that the people who are being selected for the managerial positions, they are not the right persons to control this company. And the way the certain major holder, major shareholders, they are interfering in the affairs of the company, or the Tata Trust, for instance, if they are interfering in the affairs of the company in some manner.
Sure.
So these are the kind of things which the NCLT should look into this and try to pass appropriate order so that no more mismanagement takes place in the companies.
Okay. Let me also bring in Mr. H.P. Ranina. Mr. Ranina, thanks very much for joining us, sir. We were anticipating legal recourse on the part of Cyrus Mistry. His statement yesterday made that amply clear, and he has now decided to move the NCLT today for oppression and mismanagement. That's the broad plea. Your first comment, sir.
Well, I don't know what grounds he has mentioned in his application.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have to wait and see what exactly he says. But obviously, he's giving the impression that the minority shareholders' interests are not being looked after by the Tata Group, and they are being ignored, and our independent directors have been sidelined. I think these must be some of the issues which he must have raised in the application.
Yes, if you look at the statements that he's been making, that pretty much is the sum and substance of the charges that he's been making.
Yeah, that's right. So I think now the NCLT will consider this issue, let the matter be decided. I think this is what we expected the NCLT to come up with it. Then we have to wait and watch what happens to Mr. Vadia's meeting.
Mr. Ranina, sorry, sir, I'm to interrupt you. We've got Mr. Mohan Parasaran, counsel for the Tatas, joining us. Mr. Parasaran, appreciate you joining us here on CNBC TV 18, sir. We understand that Mr. Cyrus Mistry has moved the NCLT, and his prayer is under Section 242 and Section 241, basically suggesting that there has been mismanagement and oppression of the minority, sir. Your first comments, Mr. Parasaran.
Yeah, it was expected, no?
Yes, it was expected that he would move the NCLT, and it's happened today.
Yeah, therefore, actually, he's proceeding actually after consulting his own legal expert, and there is a reason why actually he resigned from all the positions of directors yesterday, and the petition must have been drafted even, I think, 2 or 3 weeks back.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm told that the petition is coming up for hearing on Thursday for interim relief.
That's right, on the 22nd, sir.
Yes. But as of now, I think there is, no proposal to remove him as a director from Tata Sons.
Mm.
There has been no notice which has been sent.
Okay.
And therefore, I think this matter has to be argued out, no?
Mm.
And let us see. I think Tata will have to file a reply.
The Tatas have already filed a caveat at the NCLT on the 25th of October. So in that sense, they will need to be heard.
Yeah, they might have filed a reply, but no interim order can be passed without hearing them. Caveat only means that you can't pass any interim order without hearing Tata.
That is right, sir.
Yeah.
So
therefore, I think in all probability, because all of us, I think, are away from DC. I do not know who is going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And possibly, I think, I would advise them to, I think, effectively put some points, not to run away from the scene.
Mm.
But this is a matter, I think, which requires some elaborate hearing. The NCLT can't pass an order in a huff.
Mm-hmm.
It requires some sort of elaborate hearing.
Okay. And when you say some sort of elaborate hearing, give us a sense of the timeline that we're then looking at, sir, because the first hearing is on the 22nd of December.
22nd, actually, even if any reply is to be filed, I don't think that it will be fair on the part of any parties to ask for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Now there's going to be a Christmas vacation.
So,
and immediately after Christmas vacation, no?
Yes.
that will be a fair time schedule.
Okay.
And even Mr. Mistry has said he's prepared to wait for a long while, for a long battle.
So what will be the legal response, Mr. Parasaran, from the Tatas? Because the sum and substance of the charges made by Cyrus Mistry rest on the fact that, you know, Mr. Ratan Tata and Noshir Sunawala continued to call the shots even post-retirement, that Tata Sons continued to try and control operating companies, that there were violations as far as the takeover code itself are concerned. These are some of the allegations they've made. What finally is part of the prayer or the plea at the NCLT? We're still waiting for details. But what would the response be, sir?
Fundamentally, edifice that there has been an oppression or mismanagement, I think, has to fall to the ground. I think they will come out with a proper response. I do not want to say more than this. Where is the question of oppression of a minority in this case?
How do you rebut that charge of oppression, Mr. Parasaran?
No, everybody knows the history as to how their family got the shares, no? Somebody got angry, somebody divested their holdings and gave it to their family. And where is the question of now oppression? Where was the oppression? No, who oppressed? Actually, it is a case of minority oppressing the majority, you know, according to us. Therefore, let us actually wait and see. We do not want to get emotive, you know, on an issue. Therefore, let us wait and see. We will come out with a proper response. And if need be, let me also argue the matter on 22nd. We are not going to shy away, you know.
Yeah, you're saying you will not shy away. You're not. There's no question of running away from this, and the Tatas will file their response at the NCLT.
Tatas will be ready with their response. If the tribunal wants us to go ahead, we will go ahead. But actually, these are matters which can't be actually rushed through in my actually perception. It has to be argued out in an elaborate fashion. We require to file a detailed reply. Even with regard to the interim reliefs, there is a normal practice. Even though we have filed caveats, we have only got the copy of the petition only today. And actually, the petition is coming up for hearing day after tomorrow.
Yeah. Sir, you said
you can't do a magic.
Yes, Mr. Parasaran, if I heard you correct, you said that you have a copy of the petition, sir, because we're still waiting for the details from the petition. Can you share with us the details from the petition?
No, I meant to get a copy. I only got the relief portion. That's why actually, so all of us will let apply our mind, no? Each person will actually...
So can you share with us whatever details you have of the petition, sir?
No, detail. I am yet to get a copy of the petition. I think they are going to mail me the copy of the petition.
Okay.
Later in the night.
Okay.
Yeah. That's why, see, all of us are in different parts of India, no? So, we have to ourselves go through the petition, and then advise Tata, no?
So, Mr. Parasaran, yesterday you had spoken of LIC versus Aisha as being, in a sense... Escorts, my apologies. Escorts as being one of the precedents that you're likely to use as part of your arguments or your rebuttal of the charges that Cyrus Mistry is making. You know, can you share with us some of the other precedents, perhaps, that that you will be falling upon as well?
That is a fundamental case, actually. Yeah, with regard to the management of a company, the decision of the directors actually is ultimate. Now they are bringing in the concept of oppression, mismanagement, that means virtually malafides on the part of the majority. Who is the majority? They say actually Ratan Tata. But actually he forgets the fact that Tata was being actually managed by other eminent people also on the board. And does he mean that actually other people who might not want to wish to name would dance the tunes of Mr. Ratan Tata? They are actually very much pained, and they also actually equally have a cause to actually take legal action. They are very pained. They are also consulting people. They have their own independent standing in the industry.
Mr. Parasaran, basically you also said that the Tatas do not intend to remove Mr. Cyrus Mistry from the board.
See, as of now, there has been no actually action so far taken. And he has also deliberately not resigned from Tata and Sons, no? He says actually he does not want to face the EGM at all. Okay. And he wants to face some other forum. But when it comes to Tata and Sons, yeah, it's a different ballgame, no?
Yeah, exactly. But I thought I heard you say that you all had no intention of removing him from the board.
See, as of now, they wanted to actually finish off the holding companies.
Yeah.
Because normally, I think when a person is removed, actually from the main parent company, everyone thought logically he would actually also quit from the group companies where there are cross holdings. But that did not happen. And they thought, I mean, this matter, initially, everyone thought it would be resolved amicably. But unfortunately, I think that did not happen.
Okay. No, sir, just a small point of clarification. Mistry was removed as chairman of the Tata Sons board, not from the directorship.
No.
Yeah.
So I'm asking you whether the Tatas will proceed to remove him from the board. I thought you said that the Tatas don't intend to remove him from the Tata Sons board.
See, even as per the original resolution, it was made very clear that, however, he would continue as a director.
Okay. Okay, so no intention to remove him.
Therefore, there was no intention originally.
Okay.
So,
but now it might change? Now the intent might change?
No, that intention possibly still continues now.
Okay.
So far, even though they have given notices in respect of all companies, they have not given notices.
Okay.
But Tata Sons.
Okay, no original intent and no intent now either.
Yeah.
As of now.
Okay, Mr. Parasaran, would it be now that the Tata Sons or Mr. Ratan Tata and his group will have to prove in court that they have not oppressed? I would assume the charges would be that the Shapurji Palonji group is saying that their interest has been oppressed or has been not served because of chorus being continued, because of nano being continued. Now you have to give those answers in court?
See, normally the initial onus is on the person who makes these allegations.
Mm-hmm.
They have to actually discharge this onus. The burden is quite heavily on them.
Okay.
Unless they are able to discharge that onus, the burden will not shift actually to Tata.
What will be the onus? It will be there. What will be the onus on Mr. Mistry?
He can't simply make allegations and get away. No, he was actually in charge at that point of time.
Hmm. So you're saying that Cyrus Mistry will have to...
What will Mr. Mistry have to prove, sir?
Yeah, suddenly he comes out and says it's oppression. No, when he's removed, it's oppression.
Hmm.
If it is not removed, it won't be oppression, no? Because he's removed, it has become oppression.
So you're saying that he will have to substantiate the claims that he makes before the NCLT?
He has to. A person who claims oppression has to actually, the burden is on him.
Hmm.
The onus is on him.
To prove that Tata Sons were oppressive?
To initially actually substantiate strongly.
Yes.
Then only the burden shifts actually.
No, sir, substantiate what?
Substantiate that actually something wrong happened. And that was actually intended to oppress this chap, no?
Okay.
It was not to oppress this man.
Okay.
See, oppression was, he forgets actually, that was actually to oppress this man.
Okay.
That might have been some wrong decision, but that was not to oppress Mr. Mistry, no?
I get your point. So, Mr. Cyrus Mistry and his group have to prove that the decision on chorus or the decision on nano were taken to oppress the minority. It is not enough if they prove it is per se bad decisions.
All per bad decisions will not amount to oppression of the minority.
Okay.
Mm. Mr. Parasaran, when we were speaking yesterday, sir, you said that you believe that the Tatas have a strong legal case. Give us a broad sense of the direction in which the legal response will follow, sir.
No, broadly, I think we have a strong legal... I think we will only actually take up this response. There has been no oppression of the minority. In what sense there has been an oppression of the minority?
What about the charge of mismanagement, Mr. Parasaran?
See, mismanagement of the company, to what extent? Who has been affected?
No, as minority shareholders...
You did not complain earlier And now we have been actually, you are also, see, there are so many things which will now come out in the open. No, mm-hmm. Now I think unfortunate. I think they have been keeping quiet. Now I think dirty linen will be now washed in the public, and it will be so unfortunate. I think Shaporji Palonji is also a group with great credentials. Mm. I'm only, I think, sorry that I think a day has come where I think even their credentials are going to be, I think,
Mr. Parasaran, you're saying something very interesting, sir. You are saying that the Tatas have been restrained in their commentary so far. The Tatas have been restrained in responding to Cyrus Mistry so far. But as of today, there will no longer be this restraint that has been exercised on the part of the Tatas. And perhaps we are going to see a much...
So they have to. They have to. I think possibly they have shown some correspondence. I think possibly they will say... It was actually he, as an individual, who was actually trying to virtually use his position, and it was concentration of power in one individual. And virtually Tatas, in future, if that sort of a power center had continued, possibly it would have been something else. The Tata brand would have actually...
You're again saying something very interesting, Mr. Parasaran, because you seem to be alluding to the charge that, not so veiled actually, that the Tatas have been making, that this was really an attempt at a corporate coup, that Cyrus Mistry was trying to wrest control of operating companies, in concert with Nasli Wadia.
I'm not going anywhere near Mr. Nasli Wadia. Mm-hmm. That's a different chapter. Mm-hmm. I am actually only on Mr. Mistry.
So you are saying that Cyrus Mistry was perhaps trying to orchestrate a coup of sorts?
He was actually trying to wrest control and wrest control absolutely himself. Mm-hmm. For instance, not filling up the posts of actually vice chairman or deputy chairman, and actually virtually even... starting several entities so that the CSR funds did not go to the trust but go to these entities.
What entities are these, sir?
Some of the entities started by the various group companies. So all these facts will come. I do not want to speak more today, no?
Okay. Sir, Mr. Parasaran... I agree with you. But Mr. Parasaran, if the Mistry group is saying that certain decisions like Chorus or like persistence with Nano... harmed their financial interest, it would amount to oppression of the minority, isn't it? Even if the intention originally of starting Nano or persisting with it was not meant to oppress them, it ended up financially hurting them.
Minority, I say. It was actually, that's why I said you must clearly make a distinction. That was a bona fide decision taken with regard to the management of the company. Where did he have the intent of actually pulling down Shaporji, you know?
Okay, so you're saying that the decision was not specifically to oppress Shapurji Palunji, which is an 18% shareholder.
No reasonable person will come to that conclusion. No, it was not to oppress Sons.
So how do you then see this charge of oppression that Cyrus Mistry is making?
He actually makes it in, according to us, according to Tata, they have got other legal advice also. It is all fanciful.
You think his charges are fanciful?
Yeah.
Okay.
But, you know, I'm sure he has an eminent battery of lawyers giving him legal advice as well, sir. I mean, they must have thought this through. You yourself pointed out that this petition has perhaps been in the making for the last 2 or 3 weeks.
Yeah, of course. See, I respect all eminent lawyers who have been advising them. Personally, I hold them in the highest regard. I can't fault them. They have given the best of legal advice. It's a matter to be fought out in court.
Sir, I mean, his father-in-law is Mr. Chagla. Would you still say the charges are fanciful?
No. Well, maybe, but I've got the greatest respect. In fact, I hold him like a father figure, Dipal Chagla ji. That's a different issue. And you know, in Mahabharata war, you saw how actually people had to fight. No? It's unfortunate.
Okay.
Mr. Parasaran,
but if the minority shareholder in the boardroom was repeatedly requesting the majority shareholder to desist from further investments in a Chorus or in a Nano, and in spite of it, the majority shareholder persisted. Surely the minority shareholder can say that even if the original intent was expansion of the company, the incidental disadvantage is what worse to the minority shareholder. Is there not a chance?
May I just give a short reply and finish?
Yes, sir. Yes,
the
sir,
minority
please.
Shareholders are aware of all these facts. They are actually in management of the company. But during the actually meetings with the shareholders, not a little finger was raised. No?
But Mr. Parasaran, as per law, sir, what happens? Because he's an 18% shareholder saying that there is oppression and mismanagement. So what are the options? I mean, what does the road ahead look like then?
Possibly we'll, I think, explore the possibility of actually making an offer to purchase.
That. Exactly. Sorry. That's what I was coming to, sir. So will the Tatas now have to consider buying out Cyrus Mistry and Shapoorji Pallonji?
Possibly, I think that option can be explored.
Is that an option that has been considered so far?
Not yet. So I think Tatas have not been, I think, so ambitious. But that's an option open in law. That's not been actually, frankly speaking, that's an option which has not been considered.
Any other form of rapprochement, you think, sir?
So, other form of rapprochement, I think, see, I personally feel, I think, as an individual, the entire thing is so unfortunate because I have also known both the groups, but I do not know whether there's going to be any rapprochement at all. And let us see what happens, no? How things take shape.
But Mr. Parasaran, you said that the option to buy out the Shapoorji Pallonji stake could be something that the Tatas may consider. It hasn't been considered so far. What could the other options be, Mr. Parasaran? Because you yourself said that this is something that the Tatas have not explored as of yet.
Yes. But I think possibly, I think they can be driven to that. No, I'm only actually speculating.
We're all speculating, sir. But you know, you're working with the Tata, sir. You're the legal counsel. So you believe that, given the fact that now Mr. Mistry has moved the NCLT, they will now need to seriously explore this possibility of buying out the Shapoorji Pallonji stake.
Yeah, I think it will be prudent. I think
it will be prudent on their part to buy him out.
Yeah.
That would be your advice, sir?
Yes.
Okay.
Your advice to them would be to look at the buyout option as a serious option.
Just to put an end to the disputes.
Okay. Just to put an end to the disputes.
You think that that is what really this is now about, sir? Do you believe that this is really about that possibility?
It was really not about that, but I think, in a war like this, it starts with something and ends with something.
Yes, that is true. So, Mr. Parasaran, before we let you go, sir, you've left us with several interesting possibilities to pursue. You're saying that perhaps the restraint that the Tatas have exercised will no longer hold, that there may be now revelations from the Tata side, dirty laundry being washed in public on both sides. Of course, that's been something that we've seen happen over the past 8 weeks. But you believe it's going to get more acrimonious, it's going to get more bitter. And at the end, you believe that your advice to the Tatas would be that it would be prudent to settle and a buyout should be a possibility to consider.
Yes.
All right.
Well, Mr. Parasaran, always a pleasure, sir. Thank you very much for joining us. That is the big headline there coming in from the council for the Tatas, saying that he would advise the Tata Group to consider buying out Shapoorji Pallonji's 18% and putting an end to this bitter battle. Remember, that is one of the options under the law, because Cyrus Mistry is accusing the Tatas of mismanagement and oppression as a minority shareholder, and this would be one of the options as per law. Let's bring in our reactions now. Mr. Ranina, you just heard what Mr. Parasaran had to say right here on CNBC TV 18, sir, as a response. What do you now make of it? Do you think that this is finally going to boil down to the buyout option?
Yes, that option is always there. But the question is, you need a willing seller. A buyer just can't say that he wants to buy him out. The Shapoorji Pallonji Group must be prepared to sell. If they dig their heels in and say, we don't want to sell, that there's no option on the table.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Rani, now, what did you make of Mr. Parasaran's statement, sir? Do you think the Tatas will seek to buy out? Do you think they will seek some other kind of rapprochement?
No, the question of buyout, as I said, will only be there if both parties agree. Mm. But if the Shapoorji Pallonji group refuses to sell, then that option doesn't exist.
Mm.
Then the other question will be, what will be the other form of settlement?
Yeah.
That remains to be seen. Maybe they will decide that, you know, he may continue, he may be reappointed as a director of other companies, as a non-executive director. Some type of settlement can be reached, but for any settlement, both parties have to agree.
Sure.
Okay. But you seem to get the feeling that the Tatas are wanting a settlement from what Mr. Parasaran said?
I get that feeling. Certainly, they would like to have a settlement, and that's understandable.
Mm.
And but of course, they want a settlement whereby the pinprick of Shapoorji Pallonji group is no longer there, so
sure.
that they have a free hand. No. I think that is a settlement certainly Tatas would like to have.
So is there a possibility that some company or companies of the group would go to the Pallonji group? And
yes, that could be one of the basis of settlement, where certain companies may go to the Shapoorji Pallonji group and certain companies may remain with Tatas. That could be certainly a settlement that could be acceptable to both parties. So one doesn't know exactly how it will pan out.
Yeah.
I think we'll have to wait and watch as this case progresses so that we know exactly what are the issues which are brought before the NCLT.
Sure. Mr. Ranina, please hold on. We've got a whole panel of experts with us. Let me also go across to MR Venkatesh. Mr. Venkatesh, thanks very much for joining us on CNBC TV 18. You've just heard what the counsel for the Tatas, Mr. Mohan Parasaran, has had to say. Your first response, you're smiling already, Mr. Venkatesh.
Now, see, Mohanji is a great personal friend, and I hold him in the highest esteem. And those who come from Chennai hold his father as the Bhishma Pitama of legal practice. Now, what he said is probably from one side of the story.
Mm.
The fact of the matter remains that none of us are privy to the exact precise charge.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, I'm sure, I am with a panel filled with lawyers and legal luminaries. I think all of us have to look into the details. The details are not yet on the public domain.
Mm.
Whatever said and done, this will be a case of its own kind for a simple reason. He is a man who was at the helm of affairs for 3-4 years.
Yes.
Mm. Forget that he was only having 18%. That's besides the point. Here he was running the company as the managing director and chairman of Tata Sons, and he was on the board of virtually most of the other companies.
Yes.
And that man to turn around and say he was oppressed, you know, it militates against common sense in the first blush.
Okay.
He could make any other charge, but he cannot. I do not know how is a director or how is a person who was the chairman of the company running for 4 years never made this noise, almost went along with the board or had various probably all the decisions in the board need not be unanimous. And just because you differ with me doesn't mean that I am oppressing you or you are oppressing me. This charge that if I differ with you, you are oppressing me, I think militates against the genetic idea of oppression in the corporate law.
But Venkatesh, if the case was so weak, if Mistry's case was so weak, would Mr. Parasaran be speaking the language of rapprochement? Should we read that as an instance that the other side, recognizing that probably the minority has merit, should we interpret it that way at all?
I'm not for one, you know, demolishing the argument of Mr. Mistry even without reading the papers. I'm not naive enough to do that. What I'm saying is, on first blush, it does look like that there is, you know, it doesn't meet the imperial demands of oppression and mismanagement under the company law. Having said that, in national interest, again, I repeat, in national interest, we cannot allow this group to encounter what it is facing today.
Sure.
And that is a halal of the valuation. And it is not Mr. Mistry or Mr. Tata. There are several small shareholders, mutual fund holders who are actually bleeding on the valuation going down.
Yeah.
So both these people in national interest have to sit around, probably some sagacious figure, and probably the group is missing somebody like Nani Palkiwala today. And if some sagacious figure is fatherly figure is actually found out by either of these two sides and is acceptable to the other side, I think in best interest, I think what Mohanji said was that that it is not the legal side. Please don't look at it everything from the courtroom perspective.
Yes.
There is an economic perspective, there is a shareholder's perspective.
A common sense perspective, obviously.
And also a stock market perspective.
Yes.
Put all these things together and see that, you know, it is, and as Mr. I'm very surprised. In fact, I was laughing because Mohan is never known to use such strong language like washing the dirty linen in public.
Yes. I was surprised by that as well. I was surprised by that as well, Mr. Venkatesh.
So you heard it very keenly. He was also talking about that language.
Yeah.
So it is not good for both of them to wash their individual dirty linen in public. Mm. And all corporate boardrooms have certain dirty linen. Mm. So it is better that let us not stretch the issue of transparency too far.
Mm.
Let both the sides sit down and buyout is the only option.
Okay. Buyout is the only option to your mind.
You can't fix a broken saucer, can you?
No.
You can't
no.
say that the saucer is broken and then I'll try to bring it around and do some patchwork. That doesn't work.
Sure.
Either you throw it out, get a new one and see that Tata's control the whole thing. Yes, then it becomes a question of valuation. Then you have valuation experts who have people give something more, take something more.
I'll just come back to you, Mr. Venkatesh. Let me also bring in our other panelists. Suhas, you've been listening into what Mr. Parasaran said. You've just heard what Mr. Venkatesh has had to say. You believe that buyout is perhaps the only option or would perhaps be the most preferred option?
Shereen, I think what Mr. Ranina said in terms of a willing seller being there for a buyout is very essential.
Mm.
You see, we know that probably 8 out of 10 cases of minority operation and mismanagement result into buying out of minority shareholding by the majority shareholder.
Mm.
However, at some point in time, the minority shareholder needs to come forward to say, I'm willing seller, and then the question of valuation will come in.
Mm.
In this case, at this stage, it doesn't appear that Shapoorji Pallonji Group is a willing seller, wanting to sell out its stake.
Mm.
From that perspective, I've handled a couple of cases where, at least in one case, for 20 years, a minority shareholder has been fighting with majority shareholder on flimsy grounds.
Mm.
And the majority shareholder who created value into the companies has been fighting this case.
Okay.
But the minority shareholder is not willing to sell out his stake.
Mm. Okay. So in your view, Suhas?
The business is going on pretty well. The valuations are going up.
Yeah. So in your view, Suhas, how will this case proceed from here on? 6 months down the line, what will we stare at?
Yeah, I don't think we would only look at this case.
Mm.
In the kind of facts and circumstances that are there before us today, I think there will be other cases that would get filed, whether it is back and forth, whether it is filed by Tata Sons or on behalf of Tata's, or filed by Cyrus Mistry or on his behalf. I mean, if you were to apply the game theory principles to a litigation case, I don't think everything will depend not only on this case, but on other litigation. And it's going to be, we've looked at it as a boardroom battle, then we've looked at it as a shareholders battle at the extraordinary general meetings.
Mm.
And now we're looking at court battle, but this is going to be a war now.
Yeah.
Mm.
It's no longer going to remain as battles. Or small battles for win or lose. It's going to be a war.
An all-out war. Let me also
bring
in...
And that's where I don't think we should look at only this filing as a case and look at how it is going to pan out.
You mean many more cases will follow?
One strategic move with an ultimate objective to be achieved. And what that objective is it's something where I think the game theory principles would be required to be applied to understand as to where this is heading and how that would be achieved.
So 3 months down the line, more cases, you think?
Maybe got disconnected.
Okay, we'll get back to Suhas, but Mr. Jain Gupta is also with us. Mr. Gupta, you've been listening in to what the Tata Counsel, Mr. Mohan Parasaran, had to say, what our legal experts are saying, and what Cyrus Mistry has decided to do. It looks like it is now going to be an even uglier, a bitter and an acrimonious legal battle.
Yeah, I say I will go by one what people said.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it appears that Mr. Parasaran, I don't know, I may be right or wrong, but out of emotion, he probably has gone out of brief that his client would have given, because generally you don't disclose all these things in the public domain till such time you are firm on those. That is one. Secondly, I agree with Mr. Ranina that a willing buyer, willing seller. But the question is this, who has got the money? See, from where the Tata Sons are going to buy the stakes of Cyrus Mistry and family, which amounts to about 90,000 crore, which company has got that much cash? Then comes the issue of rapprochement. I, from the governance angle, will never like rapprochement for the simple reason, if there are issues which have been raised, they have to be taken to the logical conclusion. They cannot be buried after a mutual settlement happens. So I am right from day one saying that if those issues have been brought to the public domain, they have to be solved. Then comes the application in national in NCLT. Now the issue is that we do not know what is the application. First we have to see what is the relief that has been sought. Now if the relief has been sought that he has been wrongly removed, so at the best relief could be that procedure was wrong, you follow the right procedure and remove him, because law cannot say that continue with this person as a chairperson. And as Mr. Venkatesh said, that operation of minority, I don't think what is the operation of minority for two, three reasons. One, he was at the helm of affairs at Tata Sons, and he was the controlling the board. So how can we say that he operation minority? And then as far as the other companies are concerned, Cyrus Mistry is, the Mistry family is one of the shareholders of Tata Sons. Whereas those companies, if at all, then the issue of minority operation has to come. It has to come from those shareholders of those companies, because you can't say that a major shareholder, Tata Son, has a shareholder who is operating in a operating company. So I feel that all these things are very complicated. We will have to see what is the thing. But I, for one, say that it is very difficult to say that operation of minority will be there, because till such time, 4-5 years, and he had been on the board of Tata Sons for 10 years. For 10 years, there was no operation. Suddenly, operation has started when you're out. So I think it is going to be a dirty battle. But I think the valuation would not be lost if probably everything is sorted out legally. I don't want rapprochement. I don't want two sides to agree and bury the hatchet.
Point taken, sir. Let me take the same point to Mr. Shriram Subramanian, the managing director at InGovern. Mr. Shriram, you've been listening to all parties. What is your sense from what Mr. Parasaran said? Mr. Gupta believes that he has probably exceeded his brief. It could well be that that was also discussed as an option, rapprochement or buyout. What will be your key takeaways from both the filing of the case and Mr. Parasaran's views?
No, I don't think, as Mr. Parasaran himself said, that is speculative in nature. And as Mr. Renina said, there for a willing buyer, there also has to be a willing seller. So, and Shapoorji Pallonji Group has not indicated anything to the effect that they would like to sell out. And none of their comments indicate to that effect. In fact, one of the points which has not been raised here is that this is beyond personalities. Cyrus Mistry, if you read between the lines, what he is saying is it is beyond the personalities. It is to bring about greater governance at Tata Sons, greater transparency at the Tata Trust level. So that means that it could even involve takeover, which I think was one of their requests, of the Tata Trust by the Government of India, or for that matter, a listing of Tata Sons. So we can speculate on these counts, but definitely, as a minority shareholder in the operating companies, we should be worried about greater governance or the lack of transparency of some of these allegations. Now, there is a lot of dirty linen which has been coming. There are a lot of allegations which have come in the public domain. Whether some of these would be brought in front of NCLT, whether that would be discussed threadbare, we don't know. If that happens, obviously, till date, Tata Sons also has not put out anything to reassure investors in operating companies that all is well.
Sure.
So from that perspective, institutional and retail shareholders would continue to be concern about happenings at Tata Sons.
Absolutely, I don't think there's any. I don't think there's any doubt in that. But let me go back across to Mr. Venkatesh. Mr. Venkatesh, you know, this business of reforming, so to speak, the Tata Trust has been something that Cyrus Mistry has been talking about. Again, this buzz around whether there is going to be a charity commissioner's involvement, a greater involvement in the Tata Trust, whether the government is now going to intervene in any form or fashion. Do you think that we're now probably also entering the lap that will force or will require the government to take a position on this matter? So far, it hasn't.
Two, three quick issues. Till date, we are not sure about the precise legal charges traded by one against the other group. All that we have is nebulous, vague things that corporate governance is not being followed or operation mismanagement. All these things are headline stories. We lawyers, chartered accountants, would like to drill down to the precise nature of charge and how it fills in, because it has to work out with a mathematical precision. It cannot be, all that is being traded in the public domain is basically emotional, nothing concrete on both sides. Two, as far as the government is concerned, the resignation of Mr. Cyrus Mistry yesterday in all the downstream companies indicate probably that the government was with the Tatas, not with him. I'm only saying it's my judgment. I could be wrong also.
Sure.
So that brings the answer to the third level. Now, charities, whosoever it is, let it be SEBI, let it be charities commissioner, cannot step in at this point in time, in my considered view, based on such emotional statements or issues. If Mr. Cyrus Mistry has certain specific issues and brings out in the public domain that, this section, this law, this regulation has been violated by the Tatas, or if Tatas bring on Mr. Cyrus Mistry stating inter alia you have done this A, B, C, D, then obviously it makes a ground for any authority to step in. Okay. Authorities by nature cannot do a fishing and roving inquiry. They cannot step in merely on such emotional headlines. They cannot step in merely because the two people do not get along well. There has to be concrete legal issues that has to be framed before any authority can come in.
Mr. Venkatesh, actually, I want to take forward the point that Shereen is making about the governance of the Tata Trusts. Let me read out what Cyrus Mistry said in his note yesterday. Until about 15 years ago, the trustees of Tata Trust wielded no voting power at all on the Tata Sons shares held by them. Company law vested voting power in the hands of a public trustee appointed by the government, who would decide how to vote shares held by the public charitable trust. And it was my family's voting strength which constituted the largest minority voice outside the government in this role. Suhas, I want to ask you, do you think that the Mistry camp or the Mistry group, Shapoorji Pallonji group, will actually seek to attack the manner in which the Tata Trusts have been governed? Will that become the meat of the case itself? Because, you know, that has been hinted at by Mr. Cyrus Mistry in yesterday's note as well.
Yeah, Latha, I think, you know, if you were to look at the role of the government in Tata Trusts, you know, since the October of 24th onwards, whatever we have seen, I think government has kept itself out from the entire controversy, whether it is through the LIC nominees or otherwise through the charity commissioner. There has been some hue and cry all the time to say that why can't charity commissioner, you know, look at what's happening at the Tata Trust level.
Yes, because we've lost that line. It's patchy. What can I say?
This note, this point was raised even by one Mr. Naushir Mirza, who is a well-known independent director. He spoke at the NSC only on corporate governance and raised only issues of governance of the trusts. He's an independent director in Tata Power, I'm sure, and perhaps in other Tata companies as well. Mr. Ranina, do you think this case will turn that way? Although it starts as oppression of minority interest, will it ultimately seek to reform or seek to get government intervention in the governance of the trusts or ensure that governance changes on its own?
Well, that is a separate ball game. You see, the Mistry camp will have to do a lot of work with the government and persuade them to once again give power to a public trustee to vote for the companies in which charitable trusts are involved. Because Mr. Mistry has been saying that these charitable trusts are enjoying tax exemption, and therefore the government has sacrificing a bit of revenue, and therefore the government has a right to have some say through a public trustee. So that type of argument can be made, and he will have to persuade the government to take that stand. Whether he succeeds or not, I do not know. The other issue which he may do is to take up, you know, the question of amending the income, the Companies Act, especially Section 169, which talks of removal of directors. Blanket power is given to a principal shareholder to remove a director by simple majority.
But Mr. Ranina, how realistic is that, sir? The possibility of having to amend the Companies Act? How realistic is that possibility?
No, that is highly realistic, because this incident will show, this episode of Tata Mistry battle will show that you cannot sacrifice the interests of independent directors. Otherwise, you forget the concept of independent directors. Because if the principal shareholder has a right to remove an independent director simply because he exercises independence, then you're destroying the very concept of independent directors. So the question is, government must make up its mind, do they want independent directors on the board of publicly listed companies or not? And if they want independent directors, then obviously the powers of the principal shareholder have to be curbed. Like, for example, I'll give you an illustration. As I said yesterday, under Reserve Bank of India Act 1934, the board of directors of Reserve Bank can only be removed by the central government if the directors have incurred any disqualification under the Reserve Bank of India
Yes,
Act.
I remember you said that, Mr. Ranina. Okay, my point is, what is the next step? Does this just become an ugly battle when in the NCLT we will see both parties fighting it out and revealing a great deal of dirt? Is that what we will stare at 3 months down the line, 6 months down the line? How does this take its course?
Yes, it will definitely take an ugly battle, and that is why Mr. Abhishek Banu Singh has been saying from day one, don't try to wash your dirty linen in public. So it's going to be ugly. It's not going to be clean, because every side will try to bring out the whatever the infirmities of the other side. And therefore, it's going to come into the public domain. So once the case is on, it will be a fight to the finish.
Yes, it
is. There's no other solution.
You're absolutely right. It looks like it will indeed be a fight to the finish. In fact, Cyrus Mistry, in his video statement yesterday, saying that I will fight this out till my last breath. Mr. Gupta, you know, you were listening into to the very interesting points that were being made by both M.R. Venkatesh as well as H.P. Ranina. I wanted to get your comments on those points, sir.
See, I would raise first issue that why at this juncture Mr. Mistry and Mr. Wadia have decided that Tata Sons should be listed, why they were sleeping for so long, one. Then what is the objective that they have, or Mr. Mistry has, to ask the charity commissioner to take over Tata Trust? Does it mean that he wants to control the company through 18.5%? Because everybody knows that charity commissioner generally does not vote, they do not come to attend meeting. So that means you are bent upon spoiling or finishing the institution. Then I always say that every discussion, I understand that everybody is saying that Tata Trust have lot of tax exemption. Now let us see what tax exemption today. Whatever dividend you get from the Tata Sons, it has already been taxed. So there is no tax in the hands of Tata Trust whether they were exempted or not. Then second would be some other income that the trust would be getting. But when they are using this trust into philanthropy, under income tax, but whatever donation you give to cancer hospital or institution, that is already exempt. So I do not understand what is the tax exemption that is there. So to me, as it is revealing day by day, that it is now a fight to take control of Tata Sons, no less. Because what it seems that somebody wants to control, and they want to bring in all the old lords. And I don't say, but when government say that we should not be doing business, we should not be investing in business, what role government will have to take over Tata Sons? It will be retrograde step. So my point is very clear that yes, it is a dirty battle. I want all the governance issue to come into the fore, solved. But value for the shareholder should not be lost. And the moment you transfer Tata Sons to the government, probably everything will be lost.
Suhas, we lost you while you were making a point, and also if you'd like to comment on the points that have been raised now by Mr. Gupta.
Yeah, Shereen, I think, you know, going back to the earlier discussion that I was trying to make a point is in terms of public trust and Public Trust Act of Maharashtra, for example, I think what are the reasons under which and what is the cause for somebody to today go to the charity commissioner to say, okay, these are the incidences where the trust is being mismanaged. And I think that is a moot when somebody says that we would want charity commissioner to have oversight, inquiry, inspection, or taking over the trust and from the trustees, the management and operation of the trust from the trustees. I don't think there is any cause made out from the facts that appear today for someone to actually make a complaint to charity commissioner, assuming that the charity commissioner had jurisdiction to lay its hands on the Tata Trusts. Then to call upon him to act. I don't think anything that we have heard till now indicates that at the trust level there is a cause to invoke charity commissioner's oversight, supervision, etc. So I think we need very cogent reasons there for charity commissioners to come and look at what the trustees are doing.
Mr. Venkatesh, you wanted to come in on that? Sorry, just one second. I'll just get Mr. Venkatesh to come in and then get you to respond.
I have only one issue here that as Mr. Suhas says, there is nothing, there is no issue with the Tata Sons per se and or the trust. The only issue is of the board of directors inter se in Tata Sons and of course the downstream companies. I think I agree with all that point Mr. Gupta made, except that I think the institutions in India are still not at in any world stage of growth handle this particular imbroglio, probably barring the courts. And this is not a binary position as I see it evolving. Probably this requires some sort of a sagacious figure stepping in and try to bridge the whole problem. Otherwise, I think this is the halal of the group. As I repeatedly said, this is the halal of the group and evaluation. Please understand, it is not a battle between Mr. Mistry and Tata. This is hard-earned savings of several people which has been put in. And if things go spiral out of control, and if you go to the courts, court is only a binary position. Somebody is right or somebody is wrong. It is not a question of valuation. It doesn't look at it from a valuation perspective. It doesn't look at it from an economic perspective. It will start looking at it whether it fits in a particular section or a sub-rule. And this cannot be a battle of sub-rules and rules. This is a far greater importance to the national economy. So I believe that at some point of time, both the groups need to shed their egos, shed their acrimonious position, and try to sit down in a negotiating table. And there are billion ways on which you can buy out the other group, and you can find out ways of doing it.
You see that happening? You see that happening? Or you see the possibility of an ugly legal wrangle?
Now, that is my wish list. I'm not saying that it is happening. Probably a portion can be brought out by the Tatas, and probably a portion can be taken over by the government mutual funds. And today, believe me or not, the banks are flush with 13 lakh crores. Demonetization has happened. And they have to park their money somewhere. So it is not a question of money or evaluation. It's a question of actually somebody sitting around and telling them, guys, you can't work together, but in national interest, this is the best.
Well, actually, I have fished out Mr. Naushir Mirza's presentation that day at the NSE, where he spoke about the governance of the Tata Trust. His first question was, who are the real owners of the Tata Group? The people of India own Tata Group through the Tata Trust. The trusts are not family trusts or private trusts, they are public trusts. The Tatas don't have a right to them. That was one of the points he made. What report of stewardship do the trusts provide their beneficiaries? What about the governance of the trust? Who regulates the Tata Trust? What are the objectives of the trust? How are the operating companies accountable to Tata Sons? These were some of the questions Mr. Naushir Mirza raised. Reason why I'm bringing these questions is, if I can put it to Mr. Ranina, do you think that, at the NCLT, these questions may be raised? That in the first place, the Tatas don't have the right of ownership at all, and the governance of the trusts and their structure, their answerability is being questioned. Do you think the case will go in that direction, Mr. Ranina?
Yes, certainly it can go in that direction, but that will not be before the NCLT. That will be done separately by the Mistry camp trying to lobby with the government to point out that all public trusts should be independently managed, and if they have any shares, then the government should have the right. It's not a question of charity commissioner coming in. Please understand, this is a different issue. Public trustee is appointed by the central government in the case of charitable trust. Mm. That has been the law in the past. Mm. Charity commissioner has no role to play in this. Okay. Charity commissioner comes in under Bombay Public Trust Act only if there's mismanagement by the trustees for misuse of funds.
Yes.
But this is a separate issue on the Companies Act, where the central government exercised voting power through the public trustee, who an independent party who was appointed by the central government.
Yeah. No, actually, to be fair, Mr. Mirza ended that speech by saying that he did not want a factotum of the government,
sure,
as he called it, to control the trusts, which have been doing good work. He was saying exactly what Mr. Venkatesh said and Mr.
Gupta as well.
Mr. Gupta, Mr. Parasaran said that someone who both parties respect, someone like Nani Palkiwala, who of course is no more, but someone who comes and, you know, ensures that both the trusts and Tata Sons are governed or are governed by people whom both sides respect. Do you think that would be the way this case will go, Mr. Ranina?
Yes, that is one suggestion which generally the courts make. Even the Supreme Court in many cases have requested two warring parties to come to some settlement to appoint a mediator and let the mediator then decide and who will then report to the Supreme Court. So this has happened in the past in the case of many families where there have been factions and they're fighting with each other.
Hmm.
So I quite expect that this suggestion will come from the NCLT or if the matter goes to the court, from the court itself.
Mr. Subramanian, you know, we continue to now deal with uncertainty and, of course, what happens at the NCLT, how soon we actually see things progress, whether or not we are going to see... we've lost Shreeram Subramanian, but let me go back across now to MR Venkatesh and get wrap-up comments from him. Mm-hmm. Mr. Venkatesh, you know, I think everyone who's spoken unanimously believes that the best way forward would be to, as you keep saying, get someone sagacious to play mediator. But if that were not to be the case, then starting the 22nd, which is when the NCLT will take up the matter, you know, what is your expectation?
See, I sincerely believe it is beyond NCLT's competence, though legally it may have the lawyers, there will be judges. This is not merely an issue of legality. This is something far more beyond legality. So I'm not questioning their legal competence. I'm questioning the competence of the system to handle this type of complex cases. And that is why I said that this has to be, somebody has to go beyond, probably over a cup of tea, make both Mr. Ratan Tata and Mr. Mistry come home and discuss the whole problem and tell them, hey guys, this is not the way it has to be done. Mm. And both of them must unconditionally surrender themselves to that gentleman. And that, I think, I'm sorry to say, it can be a politician, it can be a retired judge, it can be a family friend, it can be anybody. But I'm sorry to say that type of persons who I could readily think of, somebody like Nani Palkiwala, is no longer existing in our public domain.
Mm.
And everybody has, unfortunately, the longer the war continues, people will start taking positions also, which effectively rules them out of even playing that role.
Sure.
So quicker it is done, the lesser amount of nothing will happen, and we can have a safe and a very smooth arbitration.
Well, okay. Actually, my colleague Kritika Saxena, who was at the EGM of Indian Hotels, reports that actually shareholders at the EGM asked Mr. Deepak Parikh to step in as the mediator.
I don't know how that is going to work, Latha, given the fact that independent directors, and as was said, that it was Mr. Parikh who was in that sense leading the independent directors at Indian Hotels, supporting Cyrus Mistry. So I'm not sure whether that will be the preferred course of action, but that is certainly a suggestion that's coming from shareholders to the Tata, suggesting that Deepak Parikh step in as a mediator. Mr. V.R. Mehta also joins us now. Mr. Mehta, thanks very much for joining us again on CNBC TV 18. Yesterday, Cyrus Mistry had, in his statement, spoken of taking legal recourse, and today he has moved the NCLT, alleging mismanagement and oppression. Your first reaction, Mr. Mehta?
This is no surprise after what he said yesterday. But beyond that, I would not like to comment anything at this stage because I do not know what exactly is the content of this move before the Company Law Tribunal and what are the remedies that he sought.
Okay.
So until that is known very clearly and very specifically, it will be difficult to say what it is. The only thing I can say that the Tata Trust have been fully compliant with the law until now. So there is no issue of the trust having any issues as far as legal compliance is concerned.
Okay, Ms. Mehta, in your considered opinion, what do you think is the next step of this case? Does it get fought at the NCLT with both sides washing dirty linen as is inevitable in a case like this? Or do you think there are signs of rapprochement? Chances of rapprochement?
I have no knowledge, no inside knowledge of what the moves will be. I can only say that once Mr. Mistry has moved the tribunal, then Tata will perforce have to respond. That is inevitable.
Right. So, Mr. Mehta, you know, we just heard from the Tata Council, Mr. Mohan Parasaran, there saying that, you know, it might be prudent, in fact, for the Tatas to look at a possible settlement by way of buying out Shapurji Palamji's stake in Tata Sons. I don't know if you have an opinion on this, but do you believe that that perhaps is the best way to end this bitter battle?
No, I have no comment on that. I'm sorry. I wouldn't know about this. The amounts involved are massive.
Yes, they are massive, sir.
So you don't think it's a feasible solution at all?
No, I won't say anything more than that. That's all.
Okay. No, but is there a willing seller, as Mr. Ranina raised? Even if there is a willing buyer, is there a willing seller, you think?
I don't know either. Firstly, whether the seller is there to sell his stake and whether there is going to be a buyer and where the resources will come from.
Mr. Mehta, has there been any communication of any sort, sir, from Tata Sons to the Tata Trust on the developments that have taken place over the last 24 hours or perhaps even prior to that?
No. As you know, we are non-executive trustees. So we don't have an idea of day-to-day happenings. But as far as I'm aware, no such communication has been received at this point of time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mr. Mehta, always a pleasure, sir. Thanks very much for joining us. V.R. Mehta there, trustee of the Sardarabji Tata Trust. Mr. Ranina, let me get final comments from you, sir, before we let you go.
Well, my final comment is that this is something which we'll have to wait and watch. Let's see what the allegations are, what points are made by the Cyrus Mistry camp in their petition to the NCLT, and how the matter will be resolved. And my only view is that possibly if they want a mediator, they will appoint a retired Supreme Court judge. Because they won't appoint any outsider. It will have to be a Supreme Court judge, retired Supreme Court judge.
So you don't give much credence to the shareholder request of Deepak Parekh stepping in as mediator?
No. Because Deepak Parekh is already an interested party, having been on the board and having taken the side of Cyrus Mistry.
Yes.
And pass the resolution. So I don't think he can be accepted. That's only a shareholder's opinion. Yeah. They will have to appoint a retired Supreme Court judge, and that person will then decide how to mediate and how to come to a settlement.
You think that's a possible course this case might take?
In fact, that will be a suggestion made from the bench. I'm quite sure about that.
Okay.
Because this has been the trend in the past. And they will therefore suggest the appointment of a Supreme Court judge.
All right, Mr. Ranina, thank you very much for patiently staying with us through this discussion and giving us your views. Mr. Shriram Subramanian, just tell us what should we be prepared for as the next headline. How does this case proceed?
No, definitely, as a minority shareholder on the listed companies, I would be worried about what is happening there. I hope better sense prevails on both grounds. Definitely, there needs to be greater transparency at the Tata Sons and at the Tata Trust level. And the conflict of interest
between the trustees and the board of directors at Tata Sons and at the operating companies needs to be ironed out.
Okay.
And obviously one needs to look at what is the premise on which Mr. Mistry is filing this in the NCLT, and based on that, the minority and this one. But obviously there is a greater... he would be prepared for a legal battle. There would be a lot of material that he would probably reveal.
Okay.
So we have to see what is the material that is presented.
Sure. Speaking of the material that is presented, I now have more details. So, Suhas, let me come to you. The petition filed by Cyrus Investments and Sterling Investment Corporation against trustees of Tata Trust and directors of Tata Sons, the petition makes out a case of the abuse of the articles of association by outsiders, B, a breakdown of governance, and C, a loss of ethical value. So this is the additional information that I now have. The petition is filed against the trustees of the Tata Trust and the directors of Tata Sons. It makes out a case of the abuse of articles of association by outsiders, breakdown of governance, and loss of ethical value. Suhas, your first comments.
I think if this is an action in NCLT against the trust, the preliminary issue that will be kind of framed probably and will have to be looked at is whether the trustees, who are outsiders in the sense of Tata Sons, whether they can be brought within the purview of action under Companies Act before NCLT. That would be the preliminary issue that will have to be tackled. Having said that, probably this action preempts the fact that Mr. Mistry continues to be on the board of the Tata Sons. The preemption there could possibly mean that he's wanting to hold on to continue to be a director on Tata Sons board.
Mr. Gupta, I've just read out now the additional details that we have. The petition has been filed by Cyrus Investments and Sterling Investment Corporation against the trustees of the Tata Trust and directors of Tata Sons. The petition makes out a case for three things: the abuse of the articles of association by outsiders, breakdown of governance, and loss of ethical values.
See, as you read the petition, all these things are allegation without any concrete proof. It is only allegation at this stage. Mm-hmm. So it will have to be seen what happens. But I tell you one very simple thing. Of all the episode, I am reading only one thing, that it is a ugly battle for control of Tata Sons. Mm. If you read one by one statement, list Tata Sons, charity commissioner should come in and have the voting right, trustee should not have a voting right. So that means if there is an objective that Mr. Mistry wants to hold on to Tata Sons and take control with 18.5% equity, so all that we are talking about, rapprochement, a senior judge doing it, if my objective was different of taking over, or if my objective was only to bring out the governance issue, it can be solved. But here the objective is totally different. Objective is to get control of Tata Sons. And that objective, I don't think any rapprochement can solve. Mm. And this case, as everybody is saying, it is going to continue for long because it is not an easy case. And it cannot be proved. First, operation cannot be proved. Secondly, breakdown of governance. What do you mean by these high-five words? What is the breakdown of governance? You have to come to specific. And only when you come to specific, you have to show it.
Mr. Gupta,
and in that case, when
Mr.
it will
Gupta.
Be very interesting. Yeah.
Mr. Gupta, chances are that that breakdown of governance will be proved by bringing a laundry list of deeds, which perhaps will not bring repute to anybody. No, my point is, you said that a rapprochement will actually hide the issues and it would be better if they were solved. I just want to know tomorrow, day after, and in the next few days and months, what happens to the minority shareholders? Will Tata Motors and Tata Steel and Tata Global and Tata Chemical seek lower and lower levels as the shit hits the roof? Or do you think this could take another course? I mean, what is it for the shareholder? Because that will be a large constituency that will be watching this case.
Okay. I will tell you, the shareholders of the listed company should not bother what is happening at the parent company, because the companies are separate and they are run independently. And if you see the price pattern, see, it appears that the valuation has been lost, but you have to read those valuations among the two factors. One, the Sensex has also lost ground. Mm. Secondly, effect of demonetization. When you talk about Tata Motors, see, every automobile company has suffered because of demonetization. And then when you read Tata Consultancy, you have to compare with Infosys.
Fair point, sir.
Last 2 months, so 3% loss has been there in Infosys as well as TCS. So I don't think you read. And secondly, with the certainty coming of the fact that Mr. Mistry will no longer be at the helm of affairs of these companies, so I think you will see stability unless until some agency finds something wrong with the company or action is initiated.
So you won't worry about
the time, it is certainty now.
You won't worry about the stocks.
Yeah, I won't worry about this.
Okay, gentlemen, please hold on. We've got our colleague Ashok Bagaria now joining us. He has a copy of the petition that's been filed at the NCLT by Cyrus Mistry and Shapoorji Palonji Investments. Ashok, can you take us through the details of the plea?
Well, in fact, we've just got some pointers from the petition. And in fact, this petition has been filed by Cyrus Investments. And it's the other parties are trustees of Tata Trust and directors of Tata Sons. In fact, they have been individually named in the petition, and a copy of this petition has already been served on them. Now, in fact, this petition is making out a case, a very important case, on three main grounds. The first, they are saying that there is an abuse of articles of association by outsiders. In fact, this is taking a direct pot shot at Ratan Tata, hinting at the fact that he, despite not being on the board of these companies, had some kind of an influence on the running of the affairs of the company. Secondly, the second major allegation that is being made out is that there was a total breakdown of governance in the Tata Group of companies, and this had resulted in the loss of ethical values which were established or which were put in place by JRT Tata. So these are primarily the three grounds on which this petition is resting on. And in fact, 22nd December is the date of hearing in the NCLT, and that's the day when we'll see a lot of arguments peddled back and forth.
All right, Ashok, appreciate you joining us. Jain Gupta, Shriram Subramanian, Suhas Tuljapurkar, MR Venkatesh, thanks very much for joining us here to take us through the big breaking story. You heard it first on CNBC TV 18, Cyrus Mistry moving the NCLT. Now, Indian Hotels held its extraordinary general meeting despite Cyrus Mistry stepping down as the chairman of the company. What promised to be a battle royale turned out to be a bit of a whimper. Indian Hotels said the meeting cannot be called off for technical reasons, and it will give shareholders an opportunity to be heard. But even after Mistry's resignation, the EGM was not devoid of drama.
Ratan Tata entered the fourth EGM of a group company in the last few weeks, but unlike TCS, Indian Hotels did not promise any fireworks after Cyrus Mistry's resignation. Independent directors Deepak Parikh and Nadir Godrej, who voted against Mistry's removal as chairman at a IHCL board meeting, were in attendance.
Rakesh Sarna, the MD and CEO of IHCL, chaired the EGM. However, with Cyrus Mistry having resigned, the meeting was pretty much redundant, and that's exactly what he said. His speech concluded in 10 minutes. However, to value shareholders' time, they let shareholders talk as an informal expression and express their opinion. And here are the top points that shareholders had to make.
Majority of the 40 shareholders who got a chance to speak backed Tata Sons. Most were happy that Mistry had stepped down, but they were also angry over the delay, which according to them has tarnished the Tata brand and led to erosion of value for shareholders.
Sorry to say, Cyrus Mistry has tarnished our image. He should have resigned long ago.
I fear our valuation means we may get eroded. Which empire was built, then market capitalization going down, like we shareholders have a real problem.
Here at the Shapoorji Palonji headquarters, we saw Cyrus Mistry entering the building early in the day, and more or less it was business as usual. But looking at the developments, it won't be wrong to assume that a new chapter in the form of a legal recourse could soon be added to this whole Tata Mistry saga.
Inside the EGM, not all shareholders were happy about Mistry's statement of taking Tatas to court. Many addressed Ratan Tata directly and asked him to resolve the matter out of court. Some even requested Deepak Parikh to step in and broker peace between the two parties.
Some senior persons who have the confidence of Mr. Ratan Tata and Cyrus Mistry, they should see that both sit together, and in his presence the matter should be sorted out.
But the big surprise statement was from one shareholder who until 3 months ago was the finance director of the company. Anil Goel, the ex-CFO of the firm, who retired in August 2016, made a statement as a shareholder defending the decision of the board and management of IHCL over the last 10 years during his tenure. He also denied Tata Trust playing any role in decisions taken by the management. Echoing his sentiments was former GIC head Mahesh Rao, who was also on the board of IHCL until 2 years ago.
During my time in association with the organization, at no point in time did anybody from any Tata Trust ever coerce me or request me for any information that they were not entitled to.
Never. That's one thing I can categorically tell you. Please don't take that into account.
As per protocol, the Tata Steel EGM will take place tomorrow. It'll be important to watch out as Nasli Wadia still remains director on the board. Of course, Tata Motors and Tata Chemicals will also see a high voltage drama as Nasli Wadia is also director on the board, unless, of course, there's a last minute change in plan. In Mumbai with Kritika Saxena, Priya Sheth.
Well, that's what happened at the Indian Hotels EGM today. Of course, the resolution to remove Cyrus Mistry was redundant because he attended in his resignation last night. But coming up next, an exclusive interview with the legal advisor to the Tatas, Mohan Parasaran, on what he makes of Cyrus Mistry moving the NCLT.